Good morning. Let me welcome you to this precious place of worship as we gather to praise our Lord who has so blessed us in many, many ways. We are here at Pittman Park United Methodist Church, and as we are gathered in this place, I know that some of you, it may be that this is your first time out to be gathered in a sanctuary again. We are distanced from each other here, but I appreciate your being present in this place. We also want to acknowledge those that are joining together for worship in our fellowship hall for the modern service of worship, and those especially who are joining with us for the online broadcast. We're glad that you are here and part of what is going on today. As we continue to move through these uncertain times with the COVID-19 virus that circles through our community, we hope that above all that you will stay safe in every possible way. We do have hand sanitizer in a number of the places in the building where you would most frequently find yourself, and so please feel free to use that. And I see that everyone here has a mask on, and glad that you're cooperating with that as well. We are grateful, and we look toward that day in which we would actually be able to hug each other's necks and share in conversation. Can't you imagine what it will be like when we are actually able to sit down across the table with each other at our Wednesday night gatherings again? That will be a wonderful thing. We'll keep you informed as the church moves into these different phases, and we have a group of individuals, a task force in our church, that will continue to give guidance to all of this. But right now, as we place our hearts together before our wonderful Lord and Savior, let us center ourselves in prayer and focus our thoughts. We turn to this time of prelude and listen as Tina shares with us.
Thank you. Let us bow together for the invocation. It is with grateful hearts and faith in you, Heavenly Father, that we bow in prayer. Dear God, we ask you to fill our hearts with love for those less fortunate, those patients recovering from COVID-19, those families who have lost loved ones to this disease. And we ask for your protection for those whose work causes them to be at risk for infection. We ask that you guide us and all nations toward peace. Thank you for all the blessings you provide.
Good morning. Good morning. It's great to see everybody this morning. Today we're going to worship the Lord with all four verses of Love Divine, All Loves Excelling. Stand if you're able, and the words are going to be up on the wall.
The third day he arose from the dead, he ascended into heaven,
and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. The morning prayer. God of life, you have promised to be with us every day, even in difficult days, especially in times like these days of coronavirus 19. Give us clear heads, clarity in our minds, strength in our work, and discernment, even in those double shifts at work when we must cover for sick or ill co-workers. Father, give us rest for our bodies as we sleep, and provide us peace in our hearts and minds. Be with our first responders, EMTs, firemen, and peace officers who risk life and limb at each 911 call for help and throughout their days. Father, be with the scientists, physicians, and laboratory technicians who are laboring day and night to discover and refine the vaccines and medications to protect us against microorganisms that threaten our world. Father, be with our soldiers, sailors, airmen, Marines, and Coast Guardsmen who maintain their unending sentinel duties 24/7 and put their lives on the line to keep peace across the globe. Father, we ask you to extend your healing hands to those who need help more than we do ourselves. Father, thank you for your Son Jesus. Help us to follow him and offer your love to those less fortunate. And now let's pray the prayer taught to us by Jesus. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
It's a wonderful thing to be around someone who has a heart of thanksgiving. If you haven't met Larry over at Walmart here in town, you're missing something. He used to work as a greeter at the door. When you would see him, he would be saying something like, "Welcome to Walmart, we're glad that you're here." They have repositioned him. Now he's welcoming people into the self-serve checkout area there in Walmart. You may know who I'm speaking of. Sue sent me a picture from her phone to my phone the other day. She had gone into Walmart, and Larry was decorated for the 4th of July. I don't know how he did it, but he had banners and flags coming out of his hat. And he was quite a spectacle. And she said, "Larry, can I take your picture?" But he was celebrating. He was celebrating for sure the nature of last weekend and the celebrations of our country and its birthday. And so, but this is a spirit that sort of is a part of who he is. And it should be a part of us. Not that all of us will be like Larry, but that we should be known for our sense of gratitude. In fact, I believe that the early church must have been known for its gratitude. They were constantly thinking of ways in which they could give themselves away for the sake of Christ. And it was because they felt like they had been so cared for. As we enter into a time of reflection and giving God thanks. I'll remind you that offering baskets are available at either door as you exit the sanctuary. We encourage you in your giving, even more so, we encourage you in your living, that every ounce of who you are would be this expression of gratitude to God every day. Let's bow our heads. Loving God, we have gathered today rich in blessing, and it is all because of you. In fact, we lift up our hearts and our minds just to give you thanks for the good world, things both great and small that you have made a part of life, and for human life in general, and our lives, and our family, and our friends in specific. For everything about it, lest we would miss one thing that you have set in motion in this span of time from birth until death. We pray, Father, for all that you have made possible in our work and in our leisure. We thank you for good humor and for encouragement. We are grateful to you for those who are young and those who are aged. We are filled to overflowing with a sense of joy when we think about the ways in which you have invested yourself in our lives. For truly, we do know that you pay attention to who we are and that we matter to you. In these times in which we encounter doubt and sorrow, we pray for your encouragement to get us back on track once again. We pray not only for your healing of disease, but we pray for your healing of our spirits, our hearts, our minds, to be in right order. Preserve us, we pray, that in some way this day you might know how grateful we are for all that you've done. We ask it in Christ's name. Amen. Amen.
Scripture this morning is taken from Genesis, the 22nd chapter, verses 1 through 19. We're reading from the New Revised Standard. After these things, God tested Abraham. He said to him, "Abraham," and Abraham said, "Here I am." He said, "Take your son, only son, Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains that I shall show you." So Abraham rose early in the morning, saddled his donkey, and took two of his young men with him and his son Isaac. He cut the wood for the burnt offering and set out and went to the place in the distance that God had shown him. On the third day, Abraham looked up and saw the place far away. Then Abraham said to the young men, "Stay here with the donkey. The boy and I will go over there. We will worship and we'll come back to you." Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it on his son Isaac, and he himself carried the fire and the knife. So the two of them walked together. Isaac said to his father, Abraham, Father. And he said, Here I am, son. He said, The fire and the wood are here, but where is the lamb for a burnt offering? Abraham said, God himself will provide the lamb for a burnt offering, my son. So the two of them walked on together. When they came to the place that God had shown him, Abraham built an altar there and set the wood in order. He bound his son Isaac and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. Then Abraham reached out his hand and took the knife to kill his son. But the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven and said, Abraham, Abraham. He said, Here I am. He said, Do not lay your hand on the boy or do anything to him. For now I know that you fear God, since you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me. And Abraham looked up and saw a ram caught in a thicket by its horns. Abraham went and took the ram and offered it up as a burnt offering instead of his son. So Abraham called that place, The Lord Will Provide, as it is said to this day. On the mount of the Lord it shall be provided. The angel of the Lord called Abraham a second time from heaven and said, By myself I have sworn, says the Lord, because you have done this and have not withheld your son, your only son, I will indeed bless you, and I will make your offspring as numerous as the stars of heaven, as the sand that is on the seashore. And your offspring shall possess the gate of their enemies. And by your offspring shall all the nations of the earth gain blessing for themselves, because you have obeyed my voice. So Abraham returned to his young men. They arose and went together to Beersheba, and Abraham lived in Beersheba.
Yeah, you didn't know I could do that. If only this story could be handled in a 30-minute episode. Now, that is not sharing with you that I'm going to be preaching a 45-minute sermon this morning. But there is nothing that is light about this story. Instead, it is dark and very disturbing. Nothing that you would ever find on the Andy Griffith Show. It is a puzzle not easily solved. Occasionally, we hear in the news of the unthinkable. A parent takes the life of a child or children. Fortunately, this is not something that we hear about very often. But when it does occur, I know that your reaction is not unlike mine. You think to yourself, how could this be? How could a parent take the life of a child? And in fact,
what I immediately go to in my thinking is that this is evidence of insanity. And it is born of pain. And it is distorted by this malevolent psychosis that somehow has embedded itself in the individual who does such a deed. All society would look on it in horror. In regard to this story with Abraham and Isaac, I strive to make it palatable. I focus in my mind on the angels' intervention and God's providing that ram who has hooked himself with those curly horns somehow in the thicket and hasn't been able to get loose. But at the very right moment, Abraham sees the opportunity to substitute the life of the ram for the life of Isaac. You know, this occurred on Mount Moriah, which is just a hair's breadth across the Kidron Valley from the Garden of Gethsemane. So you're getting a picture of where Mount Moriah is, are you not? Mount Moriah is where the Temple Dome is, the Dome of the Rock. You've seen pictures, some of you may have seen it in person, that gold-domed mosque that sits directly on top of this very site. It is said in tradition that the stone that is covered by the Dome of the Rock there, the stone itself is the stone upon which Abraham laid Isaac for that fateful offering. According to rabbinic legend, that stone is the foundation stone from which all of the earth was formed. That is a way of saying that this is a pivotal story in the history of the Jewish people. And in fact, in our own history as well. For us to look at it and think that it can be easily understood, easily embraced, is to do Abraham and ourselves a disservice. We minimize the nature of his dilemma. Abraham did not love Isaac any less than you and I love our children. Abraham loved Isaac maybe even more than we can perceive. With the love that we have in our hearts for our children. Because for Abraham, if you remember, Isaac was given to him as an old man, as this surprise, caring gesture from God who said, I will populate the world with your kin to the point that you're not going to be able to keep up with all of those who call themselves of your family. But you know, of course, that Abraham lived within a culture of sacrifice. Animal sacrifice, of course, that was a part of what he was used to being around. But you know as well, don't you, that Abraham, who did not own, as we discussed last week, a foot of the land upon which he spent his life, that he was around other cultures that believed in human sacrifice. The idea of it is far beyond what we can imagine. But if you served a god such as Moloch or Baal, it was not uncommon for you, out of your reverence for that god and pleading that god's help in your life, to take your firstborn child and offer that child as a burnt offering to that god. In fact, I have read this past week that it is very likely that there was some kind of mechanical structure that had been formed to look like this image of Moloch in this valley just outside of what is now Jerusalem and was then basically Mount Moriah. And this structure would have a child placed in its arms and then rotate into this terrible fire that would consume the child. I have intentionally not put any images of this up on our wall, but the mental images are almost too much to bear. In Jeremiah, the 32nd chapter and the 35th verse, it says here, they set up their abominations in the house that bears my name. This is God speaking through that prophet. They defiled it. They built the high places of Baal in the valley of the son of Hinnom to offer up their sons and daughters to Moloch, though I did not command them, nor did it enter my mind that they should do this abomination, causing Judah to sin. Do you hear what's being said by Jeremiah there? That it's not the other cultures that have become just entangled in this child sacrifice, but the people, the Hebrew people, have begun to do the very same thing in this valley, Gehenna in Hebrew, in Greek, Gehenna. Does that remind you of Jesus speaking of Gehenna? A terrible, terrible, and tragic situation in which even the kings, certain kings of Judah, would offer their own children in sacrifice. Abraham, he listened for God. He talked to God. Have you ever asked yourself, how did he hear from God? We read the scripture and it seems so very clear that God spoke to him directly, so that perhaps audibly, that he could hear what God was saying to him. And I ask you the question, is that the way that God speaks to you? It's not the way that God speaks to me. God does speak to me in my mind and in my heart at certain times in such a straightforward manner that there is no question what God is seeking for me to hear. Do you imagine that Abraham was different than you and I? John Wesley, the founder of Methodism, always was listening for God's voice in his heart and in his mind. Do you know how he detected what God was saying to him? Methodists call it the quadrilateral. It is more something that Methodist historians have put together. But if you look in his writings, John Wesley reveals that he looks to Scripture first and foremost. But then he tests Scripture with the traditions of the church, those that have written about Scripture. And then he tests that with his own experience in his life. And finally, that he uses the good logic that God has given, and his reason begins to put in his mind and his heart what God says to him. I don't know if it was that way with Abraham, but I have a feeling it wasn't so different than what you and I experience. And Abraham, as he went through his life, was observing the cultures around him offering to their gods what was inconceivable in his mind, until he realized that maybe their offerings were greater than his tithe. And he thought to himself and heard within his heart and in his mind God speaking to him and saying, take your son Isaac to the top of Mount Moriah and offer him to me. Now, this is a part of the puzzle that I'm still trying to put together. But can you imagine? In Abraham's mind, that he would have heard God say this, and that he would have said nothing to Sarah and nothing to Isaac as this began to be played out, because he felt that it was necessary for him to trust God so much that he would offer the very thing upon which the world was dependent, the life of Isaac to populate the planet. Can you imagine, as it comes to that very last moment, and Isaac seeing all of a sudden what was coming down, and the knife moving in his direction, and perhaps even Isaac letting out a shriek, as all of a sudden it occurs to Abraham, it doesn't have to be this way. The angel speaking, Abraham, Abraham, and his answering, I am here. And God praises him for what is an enormous act of faith, but saves the life of this precious one and points him toward that ram caught in the thicket. Soren Kierkegaard, a 19th century Danish philosopher and preacher, wrote a short book entitled Fear and Trembling. The entirety of the book is about this story of Abraham and Isaac. The Hebrew people call it Akedah, the binding of Isaac. And in his thinking about the story, Soren says that perhaps there are several scenarios that could be playing out. Scenario one is that Isaac lunges at Abraham and begs for mercy and for his life. And that in this instance, Abraham, loving God as he does, takes the blame for what's going on, in order that Isaac might not think that God would do such a thing to him, but that Abraham takes that blame. saying, do you think this is God's command? This is my desire. Scenario two, Abraham and Isaac journey in complete silence as they walk toward this sacrifice. And as the narrative unfolds, the whole idea of it is so overwhelming to Abraham that from the point that he grabbed his knife and lifted it above Isaac, his life was never the same. It scarred him forever. And he carried it to his dying day. Scenario number three, Abraham concludes that he wrongly believed that God told him to murder Isaac. And frankly, to tell you the truth, this sounds a little bit like what I'm suggesting in the story that I shared just a few moments ago. Scenario number four, Abraham fails to act. That somehow, in the midst of doing this, Isaac is a willing participant finally when he realizes what is going on. And Abraham has so shared the nature of God with Isaac that when Isaac sees Abraham lift the knife to inflict that fateful pain and Isaac's death, that Abraham refuses to do it. But because Abraham refused to do it, Isaac loses his faith because he sees the wavering of the heart of Abraham. Now, you may be asking yourself, why in the world would we even consider all of this? Because you and I don't think about this story, not to the degree that it deserves to be a part of our lives. This story will always remain opaque. There will be a part of it that is mysterious now through a glass darkly, but then face to face we may understand one day. But it is very difficult for you and I if we stare into the darkness of this story. I love St. Teresa of Avila's words. She was a 16th century Carmelite nun. And she, as the story goes, was riding on her horse and fell off at the edge of a river that was swollen by rain and was almost swept downstream to her own demise. And when she was able to regain her footing and get back up on dry ground, her comment was, God, if this is the way you treat your friends, it is no wonder why you have so few. You may be thinking to yourself about your own life and the difficulties that you've had to bear, and they control us. It is possible that we can be so fixed on these things that they can take all control, robbing us even of our faith. I've wondered to myself on this story if God was not in some way living out through Abraham his own sacrifice of Jesus, which was far yet in the future at the time of Abraham. Can you imagine this occurring? God looking into the life of Abraham and thinking to himself, he loves so purely. He trusts so completely. He is a person of such faith. How would he handle it if he were going to be in the situation that I anticipate being in? And now we know his willingness only stopped by the precious hand of God. The writer of Hebrews seems to understand all of this as he reflects on the nature of who Jesus is. He talks about the sacrifice of Jesus. Consequently, when Christ came into the world, he said, "Sacrifices and offerings you have not desired, but a body you have prepared for me. In burnt offerings and sin offerings you have taken no pleasure. Then I said, 'See, God, I have come to do your will, O God.'" When he said above, "You have neither desired nor taken pleasure in sacrifices and offerings and burnt offerings and sin offerings," then he added, "See, I have come to do your will." He abolishes the first in order to establish the second. And it is by God's will that we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once and for all. Over in the 11th chapter of Hebrews, we find these words: "By faith, Abraham, when put to the test, offered up Isaac. He who had received the promises was ready to offer up his only son, of whom we had been told, 'It is through Isaac that descendants shall be named for you.' He considered the fact that God is able even to raise someone from the dead, and figuratively speaking, he did receive him back." Speaking, of course, of not only Isaac, but Jesus as well. Of course, we know that Jesus was a willing participant in this. Do you remember the prayer that Jesus prayed at Gethsemane? "Let this cup pass, Father, but nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done." When you and I think about this story, we need to think about the deep nature of sacrifice. In Abraham's life, as a man of faith, in Jesus' life, as the Son of God, and in our lives, people who call ourselves followers of Christ. Do you remember the young man that came up to Jesus in all of his wealth and his fancy garments that no doubt he had on? And he asked Jesus the question, "How might I enter eternal life?" And Jesus said, "Well, keep the commandments." "And what are they," he said, "that I might keep them?" And Jesus repeats to him the very things that he knows, that the man already knows. He's been trained in it in Judaism from his earliest days, that you should love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, that you should respect and honor your parents, that you should not murder, that you should give of your life in truthfulness, not in deceit, in relationships, and that you should love your neighbor as yourself. And the man said, "And I've done all of these things." And Jesus looks at him and says, "Give of what you own. Divest yourself of your riches and give to the poor. And then come and follow me." And with that challenge, we do not know the rest of the story, but assume that it was too much of a challenge for the young man, what Jesus was putting before him to do. You and I must listen in order to hear God's will in our lives. Will Willimon, who is now a retired bishop, a retired Methodist bishop, was just a few years back the dean of the chapel at Duke University. And he would, on occasion, go with groups and sometimes send groups of students on mission trips. And one of the students that was a part of the campus ministry association there came back so inspired by this foreign mission trip that she had been on that she decided and shared with Will Willimon that she wanted to become a missionary herself. Well, Bishop Willimon was happy for her that she had come to this discovery in her heart. But the parents of this young girl, they called and requested to meet with Will Willimon. And when they got to his office, they began to berate him at having led their daughter off course and said to him, "It is fine and good for her to go on a trip, but you should never have prompted her to think that she should be a missionary herself. We have raised her with such care. She is a pre-law student, and she knows that this is what she wants to do." And Will Willimon, at a pause in the conversation, just simply looked at them and said, "I'm not the one who carried her down to the altar and had her baptized. You're the ones who did that. And this is something that God is setting in motion, not me." What is it that God wishes to set in motion in our lives? I mean, think about it. How many things do we simply discount because they are bigger than what we could ever imagine ourselves to be or to do? God is asking not only Abraham what he was willing to sacrifice, but he is asking us as well. Are we listening? Are we listening?
As we conclude today, we're going to worship the Lord with "Open My Eyes That I May See." Would you stand as you are able? Thank you.
thank you for the calling that is a part of life. And we pray that you would help us to be attentive to every word that comes from your mouth. We ask that you would help us to be courageous. And in hearing what you wish for us to do, and in hearing who you wish for us to be, we pray, Father, that you would give us strength to move in the directions that you call. Bless us as we go forth from this place today, and give us hearts, again we ask, of gratitude and of praise, of joy. Fill us to overflowing. We ask it in the precious and holy name of Jesus the Christ. Amen.